Welcome to the Kingmakers IAS Academy Initiative 5 Editorials of the Week. In this initiative, we will be seeing the 5 important editorials from various newspapers, and we will take stock points that is important for your note making as well as for your answer writing in the mains. So here we go with this 5 topics. I'm Madhavi presenting you this program. The topics of discussion today is the first, the flood management that cannot be watered down. This was taken from The Hindu, 27 September. The second, revitalizing PM Kusum scheme, how to grease the wheels of justice. Fourth, a scheme before its time. Fifth, a state, a clean sweep and the art of sanitation. I have also clubbed this editorial, fifth editorial, along with another editorial, no clean sweep, to give you a comprehensive idea about the Swachh Bharat mission. So let's get to the topic first. The flood management that cannot be watered down. This topic is very important as it is there in the syllabus GS1, important geophysical phenomena. As flood is one of the geophysical phenomena, we have to learn that. And also in GS3, disaster and disaster management is also there. So this flood management as one of the disaster management is important for you to have your notes for. Coming to this particular background of this particular editorial, as you all know, there are a number of rivers which are flowing in India. There are certain important rivers which are transboundary. So those transboundary rivers are those which are crossing the boundaries. As you all know, this geographical phenomena does not know boundaries that is politically made. These rivers which are geographical or transboundary, that is they are crossing the boundary. So these like Brahmaputra, which is originating in the Himalayas, which is there in China, it is flowing through the India, and those tributaries of Brahmaputra flows from Bhutan, Nepal, and so on and so forth. And similarly, we have this Indus and Ganga, which is also transboundary, which is crossing China, Nepal, and then coming to India. This Indus is crossing China, then India, and then going to Pakistan, and at last flowing into the Arabian Sea. And here we have the topic of the discussion today is about this Ganges rivers and their tributaries, which are flowing from China, then to Nepal and India. The context of discussion here is only between Nepal and India. Let's get it to the stock points. Bihar's district facing floods recurrently. There are certain tributaries of this Ganges rivers, which is flowing from Nepal to Bihar. And this Bihar is flooded during the monsoon season, where there is lots of rain and these rivers are flooded. And these rivers like Kosi, which is actually called as this Sorrow of Bihar. So Kosi River and other tributaries of Ganges is important problem, which is a disaster for these Bihar districts. Points to be noted. India-Nepal flood arrangement provides enough room for better coordination between center and state government. So here, the author is talking about India-Nepal cooperation to tackle this disaster management. And this also needed a center-state cooperation. That is, the central government, which is having this foreign affairs, have to engage with this Nepal and then take this problem of Bihar to Nepal to solve this problem of flood. So there is a need for center-state cooperation so that there is a cooperation between India and Nepal for this flood management. Need for process-driven coordination between center and state of Bihar. There are processes. There are processes in which the rivers originate and the rivers flow and rivers create lots of sedimentations and other processes. And also there are processes in flood management. So flood management needs embankments, barrages, and other constructions which will actually prevent the floods or reduce the impacts of flood. That is that needs to be constructed in these Kosi rivers and other tributaries of this Ganges. So there is a need for a process-driven coordination between center and state of Bihar. The Joint Project Office in Nepal, which was established in 2004, was created to prepare a detailed project report to prepare a high dam on the Nepal side. So this high dam will enable lots of water, which is coming from this the Kosi rivers from the upper reaches of this Kosi river will be causing flood in the lower reaches of this Kosi river, which is there in the Bihar district. So this Bihar district, when in order to be protected from these lots of water coming from this upper reaches of this Kosi river, there is a need for a dam. This dam will stop lots of water and it will give a controlled flow of this water. So there is a need for a dam. But this dam cannot be constructed in the Bihar. It has to be constructed in the upper reaches, which is there in the Nepal. So there is a need for engagement with this Nepal. So Nepal created this joint project office along with India, which was which happened in 2004, to create a detailed project to construct high dam on the Nepal side on the Kosi River, Kobla River, and Bagmati rivers. But this task remains unaccomplished even after 17 years. So there is a delay in the implementation, or there is no implementation at all, or there is lots of disruptions in the implementation. The Nepal's lack of prompt reciprocation delayed the resolution of water sharing issues with Nepal is what the author is telling. So there is no reciprocation. Though we don't expect certain reciprocation according to our Gujral doctrine, which says non-reciprocity. Non-reciprocity means we will be doing good for the other countries, but we don't expect anything. But in this flood management, it is not like that. The Nepal needs to reciprocate in order to have a coordination, in order to reduce this flood problem. So the author is saying Nepal's lack of prompt reciprocation. And this also needs a prompt reciprocation because this flood can happen anytime. So there should not be a delay in the implementation of such dams. So there should be prompt reciprocation by the Nepal. We are doing so much to Nepal. At least the Nepal have to coordinate with us for this flood management is what the author is saying. So the Nepal's lack of prompt reciprocation delayed the resolution of water sharing issues with Nepal. So flood management is one thing, and also water sharing is another thing. Why water sharing is one important topic in this discussion is this. Because we were talking about flood management only, what is it, water sharing? Say, for example, when there is a river and there is a high dam which is constructed there, you know this high dam will actually retain some water. So when it is retaining some water and it is accumulating water, the lower reaches of the river will not get the waters enough. So there should be a dam constructed to in order to reduce the amount of water which is coming down in order to stop the flood. But this should not disallow more water coming, because the water is needed for the lower reaches, for the agriculture to flourish and other needs. So there should be a certain amount of water which is let down from this dam, and the other excess water is stored in this dam. So there is a water sharing issues which is also there between the India and Nepal. So flood management as well as water sharing is important problem that the author is talking about together. So because there is a dam construction which is coming into the play. Existing Nepal-India agreement on water resources under which state government can execute flood production works inside Nepal. So in this flood production on the management, there is a need for India to work in the Nepal sovereign territory. So there is a need for a permission from Nepal. So Nepal has to allow that India can transport the equipment, the personnel who are working in a dam, which is constructed in Nepal for the purpose of India's disaster management or flood management, because the rivers which are coming from the Nepal are creating floods in the Bihar. So this, you know, this requires the Indian to go there and construct a dam and do all the necessary protection and management of the flood in order to reduce the impact in the lower reaches of this Kosi and the other rivers. Nepal has provided a conditional permission, but now not coordinating well. So earlier they did go for an agreement and they also given the detailed project report, but they are not properly continuing and consistently coordinating with India, which is creating a problem in executing this project and reducing the impact of flood. Government of Bihar approaching Nepal local authorities and the central government of India to push completion for flood production. So this scenario is a poor condition which the government of Bihar constantly has to take the issue forward to the central government and the Nepal local authorities to push for the implementation of such projects. This ensures the smooth functioning and transport of manpower, functional materials across the border of the Nepal in order to construct such dams and other barrages in the rivers in the low upper reaches. Flood production works are done by government of Bihar as well, but this requires the government of Bihar to resource the person in the Nepal's border, because it cannot be done in the lower reaches. It has to be done in the upper reaches even before the flood that will come into the Bihar's district. Issue of no man's land is also there. So certain areas are not properly demarcated. They don't know whether it is the Nepal's territory or the India's Indian territory. So that is a problem where the Nepal may say that, no, this is no man's land, you should not come there, and this is the authority for getting permission, or this is the authority for getting permission. So like that, there is an ambiguity in the authority who should permit certain permission from this no man's land, and nobody knows how to use this no man's land, and that is the issue created by it. And also, there are certain local resistances also, because when there is a construction of dams, there will be lots of displacement happens. So when there's a construction of dams, lots of trees will be cut down and lots of people has to be displaced, because these areas will be actually converted into a reservoir, and there will be lots of water which is filled in this particular area of the dam. So there is need for a displacement. So there is a local resistance from the Nepal people, and this domestic politics or domestic issue of the from the Nepal is keeping the Nepal government from not giving the permission to the Bihar government from constructing a dams, another functional construction to reduce the flood. So these issues are delaying the implementation, which is costing a lot for the people of the Bihar district. What is the way forward? The spirit of friendship between India and Nepal is very, very important. Friends, you have to ensure these words are used whenever you are talking about this Nepal-India or Indian-Bhutan relationship. And restarting the water dialogue is very important. Policies for safety from flood is required, and it's a joint policy making. So the joint statements has to ensure that there is a policy for a safety from flood. Assess the factors for causing floods that will ensure that there is a proper solution streamlined to enable that there is a flood managed. An optimization of infrastructure. Students, you also, friends, you also know that there are dams constructed, but due to the siltation problem, which is the sedimentation of the eroded materials, will cause siltation, and the capacity of the dam gets reduced. So the water capacity, the capacity of the dam to store lots of water will reduce, because there is a siltation problem which will reduce the depth of the dams, and there will be reduction in the capacity of the water which is held in the dam. This will cause lots of water to be rushed to the lower reaches. So there is a need for an optimization of infrastructure as well. Already there will be infrastructure constructed. Please ensure that this infrastructure has a higher capacity by desiltation and other repairing works, because there are dams constructed. They may be in a repaired stage, also in a wrong condition. So there should be a repairing of these dams. There are lots of dams which are very, very bad in condition. They have to be repaired, and if for repair, they'll be optimized. So this will reduce the cost, and this will also ensure the flood is properly managed. And there need not go for a new project which requires lots of permission, lots of time and all. And so there is a need for an optimization of infrastructure. Management of green cover and Himalayan glaciers is also very important. As I said, we have to assess the factors causing floods. This is what the author also said. But the one important cause or the factor of causing flood is there is a reduction in the green cover, because the reduction in the green cover will create a situation where there will be lots of runoff floods, because these trees will actually have certain roots which is penetrating deep So whenever there is a rainfall, these the rain water will actually percolate into the groundwater. When there is no tree, these rainwater will not percolate into the ground, but runoff and causing floods. So these runoff causing floods is important problem that is there in the Himalayan rivers and other rivers also. So there is a need for a management of green cover and Himalayan glacier as well. Since you know there is a lot of global warming and the Himalayan glaciers is melting so fast, and that is creating the flood. So there is a need for protection of the green cover as well as the Himalayan glaciers. The sanctity of the Himalayan glaciers is what the author is talking about. Turn crisis into opportunity. So this flood problem can be converted into an opportunity, because excess of water is actually good. When you actually make it a disaster, it is a disaster. But when you create such an opportunity using this excess water, it is a crisis that is turned into an opportunity. Water resource is a priceless asset, because these excess water can be stopped and then used to generate hydroelectric power, then flowed through irrigation, waterways, etc. So there is a need for tapping of these excess water, which is causing flood. So there is a potential in these flood water. So there is a need for a construction of infrastructure which manages this flood, also taps the energy and other features out of these water. That is what the author is saying. Crisis can be turned into an opportunity. So this quote, you can use it anywhere. Next, revitalizing PM Kusum. So this is a scheme. So there is a mention in the syllabus that General Studies 2 welfare schemes for vulnerable section. So this PM Kusum scheme, which is there for farmers, is very important for you to understand. Let's talk about the stock points, why it is discussed in this particular editorial. The premise is review of progress of the scheme by the Union Ministry of Power, New and Renewable Energy. So there was a review of progress. So let's see what are the outcomes of PM Kusum and what are the analysis made. Points to be noted. The 2019 scheme launched to help farmers access reliable solar power for daytime solar power for irrigation, reduce power subsidies, and decarbonize agriculture. So I'll decode all these words. First, yes, it was established in 2019. The scheme was started in 2019 to access reliable solar power. So like we are a country which is in the tropical area, so we get excess of solar from insulation. So this solar power has to be tapped in conversion of energy. This energy conversion helps in irrigation and reduce power subsidies as well. So we are the farmers are provided with power subsidies. That is, say for example, the power that is the electricity used by the for irrigation and other purposes of by the farmers are charged in a lesser amount. So there is a subsidy which is given in the power. So this power subsidy, which is provided by the farmers, so say for example, a power cost, say for example, 50 rupees per unit. So the farmers are provided with only 10 rupees per unit, and the 40 rupees is subsidized. And also, it is important to decarbonize agriculture. This solar energy is replacing the normal electricity, which is generated through coal or diesel, which are fossil fuels, which are highly emitting greenhouse gases. By a conversion of the energy from these non-renewable energy or fossil fuels to solar power enables the agriculture to be decarbonized. So there is a reduction in the carbon dioxide emission from those fossil fuels which are burned to produce electricity to provide for irrigation and others. So there is a decarbonization of agriculture. So the author is speaking about the agriculture which can be made climate resilient, as well as it can reduce the climate change problem. And the scheme provides incentives to farmers to install either of the three deployment models. So this PM Kusum has given a choice of three deployment models for the farmers. So they can go for an off-grid solar pump, which is a standalone solar generators, which can give electricity, and it can give electricity for the solar pumps for irrigation. or they can go for a solarized agriculture feeders. So the agriculture feeders, that is the electricity for agriculture, will be provided by a solar plants, and the solar plants will provide feed the electricity for the irrigations of acres of land. And then grid connected pumps, that is this grid connected pumps will be connected to the DISCOMs. That is, DISCOMs is the distribution companies of the electricity. So the power produced by the solar panels, which are with the farmers, will be fed to the DISCOMs, and the DISCOMs will distribute to the others. So the excess of solar energy, which is generated by the solar panel in the farmer's field, will be fed to the other purposes also, not just for the agriculture. So this is how the farmers can make money. So analysis is, in off-grid pumps, an achievement falls short. So there is the target is not achieved. The target was 2 million by 2022, which was not achieved. We were able to only achieve 2 lakh off-grid pumps in the particular farmers' fields. Only few states have initiated tenders. So this construction of solar panels and the land which has to be leased or rented to the solar panel construction has to be initiated by the state. But the state has not initiated lots of tenders, and only few states have done it. Benefits, this is very important. So benefits is, farmers have earned additional income by creating excess solar energy, and they are also able to feed to the DISCOMs. So the DISCOM will pay the farmers. And also through off-grid solar pumps, they are able to energize or provide electricity to solar pumps. So they will not depend on the other electricity, and so their cost will reduce. DISCOMs to diversify the buyers. So DISCOMs will be able to now buy from lots of buyers, not from the coal power plant, but also from the solar power, which is provided by the farmers. So the DISCOMs is able to diversify the buyers. So too many buyers now, from the coal, from the diesel, from the solar power, from the farmers. So farmers also become a seller of the electricity. So the DISCOM will buy the electricity from the farmers. So this diversification of buyers actually reduces the cost, and also there is a local procurement which can be done by the DISCOMs, which will reduce the energy. As you know, when the electricity has to be transported from a long distance from the coal power plants to the DISCOMs and then to the households, it creates lots of leakages, or there is a problem of losses, which is called as AT&C losses. So these losses are reduced, and there is a procurement which is made locally from the farmer's field. So the farmer's field providing solar power that will be distributed by the DISCOMs. This enables reduction in the losses as well as the leakages. What are the reasons why there is a less outcome compared to the target which was there in the PM Kusum scheme? Lack of awareness. So there is a lack of awareness among the farmers. And there is an upfront cost also, friends, because the solar panels requires lots of money and capital to be installed. So there is a solar panel equipments which have to be bought, it has to be connected, and it has to be operationalized, and it has to be maintained also. These costs are very huge for the farmers. And the pandemic also disrupted the scheme implementation, and also the farmers' money. And the farmers, the normal life has also been disrupted by the pandemic. And limited buy-in from states. As the states have to buy the solar power, they have not bought it from the farmers who's having excess solar power. So farmers, as the potential seller for the power, has not been tapped. So the DISCOMs is not able to tap from the farmers' solar power, and this has reduced the income of the farmers, as well as the potential where the DISCOMs can reduce the cost by tapping the solar power. And implementation challenges also is very important. That is, as I said, these require the state, the DISCOMs, and the farmers to be coordinated, and there is a need for the installation and the running and maintenance and operation and other such things. There are implementation challenges, and there is technical, operational, and financial challenges as explained. And what is the way forward? First, the author is giving certain points for a way forward for this revitalizing this PM Kusum scheme. Extend scheme deadline beyond 2022. us the DISCOMs usually will have a contract to buy power with the solar power plant. So DISCOMs will be having a contract with the power producers. So power manufacturers or power producer. In this case, the power producers are farmers as well as the other thermal power plants or other such nuclear power plants or other such things. So the DISCOM will have to get a contract with those power producers. But this scheme, only having a deadline of 2022, will not help DISCOMs to go for a long-term contract with the farmers. When the DISCOM is going for long-term contract only, they will have a potential reduction in the cost, which will ensure that there is a long-term distribution infrastructure that can be created. So say, for example, it is getting from farmers, there is a long-term contract, then there will be a feeder lines which are constructed, and then the DISCOMs will be able to distribute this power to the other households. So there is a need for a long-term contract. If the PM Kusum scheme is having only 2022 as a deadline, then there will not be a long-term contracts which can be created by the DISCOM with the farmers. So the author is saying go for a longer deadline. So scheme deadline must be extended so that a DISCOM buy the power in short term, as it has gone for long-term contract for procuring power in surplus already. And also this DISCOM have already formed a contract with other players which have provided enough power. So it has no incentive to go to a farmer and buy power because it's already having a surplus power from other sellers. So there is a need for this scheme to be extended so that the DISCOM is also going for a short-term contract with those farmers to provide power so that there is a meeting of the demand. That is, there will be peak demand of power during summer season. So this peak demand can be met by the farmers who's also producing power in larger amounts during the summer season, because solar power will be higher in the summer season. So the farmers producing excess power will feed the DISCOMs to meet the peak demand during the summer season and during the daytime. So that is what the author is giving us a suggestion for this program. Distributed power plants should be made competitive for DISCOM to buy power from by reducing ISTS charges, that is interstate transmission charges must be reduced and address counterparty risk, grid unavailability risk, standardized tariff determination. So the DISCOM should have a proper fees or proper money, charges, which is provided for the power, which is obtained from the farmers. So all these problems, if at all met out, then the DISCOM will be facilitated with the buying power from the farmers and it will be able to distribute. So this challenges, if at all met, the farmers will get an income from selling the power and the DISCOM will reduce cost by getting the power from the farmers, which is at a lower cost. So distributed power plants should be made competitive for DISCOM to buy power from these farmers, is what the author is saying. And by reducing this interstate transmission charges and other risks, which is involved in the buying of power from the farmer. And streamline land regulation through interdepartmental coordination. As the solar panel has to be installed in a large acres of land, there is a need for a land regulation which facilitates the farmers as well as the DISCOMs to go for a contract and buying of these powers. And the reduce the delays in conversion of land or leasing. Since these lands, which are agriculture earlier, has to be converted into a non-agricultural land for installation of solar panel, this land regulation and land procedures for conversion and leasing has to be facilitated for the farmers to adopt these land for solar power production. Innovative method to finance farmers' contribution. So farmers providing power has to be innovatively financed so that they are able to get the money from the DISCOM and sell those power to the DISCOMs. So this financial innovation has to be done so that there is a reduction in the financing upfront cost. Say, for example, they can go for an EMI. So this EMI will, EMI or any other financial products will enable them to buy the equipments for the solar power production. Because this upfront cost, which is needed, or a capital which is needed for product for procurement of the solar power panels and other the maintenance and the operation and all, is too huge for the farmers. So they need to be financed. For this finance, the bank or the other has to ensure there is a incentive product or a financial product or a loan kind of things or any kind of EMIs or any kind of financial products that can enable this farmers to buy easily and also not bear the cost at one time wholly in the starting, because this is very huge. Because they cannot take a lump sum capital which is required for solar power panel procurement. So this needs to be coordinated from the government and the other players like banks. And extensively pilot grid connected solar pumps and also use smart meters and smart transformers. So this smart meters and smart transformers will actually will read the amount of energy produced and the amount of energy distributed by the farmers and by the DISCOMs. This will enable there is a proper tariff determination and proper usage and proper policy makings through the data that is we got from the smart meters and smart transformers. And there is a need for an extensively pilot grid connected solar pumps. The author is suggesting instead of going for an off-grid, go for a grid connected. Because the author is saying that off-grid will create a huge cost in the operation, maintenance and other things. But the grid connected will enable the state and the DISCOMs player to coordinate with the farmers. And also the farmers will be able to gain income by selling these solar power. So that is what the author is suggesting. To go for grid connected more than the off-grid connected and also install smart meters and smart transformers along with it so that this is data driven and the PM KUSUM outcome is more efficient and appropriate. The next tutorial, how to grease the wheels of justice. This is important because in GS2 we have a judiciary as an important topic. So let's get into the topic. What is the premise? The long-standing issue highlighted by various Chief Justice of India. What is the issue? Pendency of cases. That is delay in disposal of cases or delay in giving judgment to the cases. This is very, very huge. Let's talk about the numbers. More than 40% of cases are decided after 3 years in India. 70% of the prisoners are under trials and are mostly poor citizens. Who are these under trials? They are languishing in the prisons without getting the proper judgment. That is, they are not convicted as prison, only they are criminally charged. So the criminally charged person who are in the prisons without their case has been judged, they are still languishing without knowing what is the result. They don't know whether they will be acquitted or they will be punished. So without any punishment, they are given a punishment by being in the prison. So these under trials condition is very poor and 70% of the prisoners are under trials. So 70% of the people are not having a proper judgment and still they are in the jails without knowing what is the result. So and in the 70%, mostly they are poor citizen, SC/ST candidates and minorities as well. So this study tells us that poor condition of the judiciary and in the disposal of cases, which has resulted in the pendency of cases. Three, rich, powerful and wrongdoers can actually increase the speed of the case or they can delay the cases however they want. So this actually caused the poor and the victim to think that this judicial process is too expensive, too costly, and it's a punishment as well. So actually I was thinking about certain scenarios. Say for example, you are seeing a destitute. A destitutes are run by lorries. Whether they'll take this case against the driver of the lorry to the court and the police, they will not. They just let it go because it is too costly for them to go to a police station or to a judiciary because they will lose the daily wages or they will be harassed by the police or they fear being harassed by the police and the lawyers. They have to pay the lawyers and the police for to expedite the cases. So like this, there are problems wherein the poor don't go to the police or the courts, and even if they are made as a culprit in the case, they are dead. That's all. The rich, if they are putting a case on the poor, the rich can do whatever they want. The rich can make them convict or they can do whatever they want. So this judicial process is itself a punishment for the poor and the victim. So this is causing a huge thing, which is reducing the people to go to the police and the court for arguing a case to protect them. Even if they are accused of charges, then they don't have any other go but feel the punishment by languishing in the jails as an under trial, and the cases will go on and go on and go on. This is the punishment that the poor and the victim is having. But the rich and the powerful is able to do whatever they want with the judiciary and the police. What are the measures? Filling sanctioned judicial position. Since 21% judicial vacancy has been there between 2000 and 2019, the author is suggesting please fill these sanctioned judicial position. So what is the sanctioned? You all know that there are, when you consider vacancy, there is a vacant, say for example, there are lots of seats. Which can be created. So this created or sanctioned judicial positions has to be filled is what the author is saying. You need not create more vacancy, but you have to fill the vacancy which are already sanctioned is what the author is saying. Holding judiciary accountable for delay in appointments. So if the judiciary is not appointing on time, then you hold the judiciary accountable is what the author is saying. If vacancies are filled, there is a need for 5,000 courtrooms. So work in two shifts is what the author is saying. So yes, as the others are saying, if the vacancies are filled, now there will be need for a 5,000 courtrooms. So there needs to be lots of infrastructure which has to be built. This cannot be done in a short term. So the author is suggesting that go for a shift, that is the same courtroom working in two shifts, so that it is able to accommodate one judge in the morning and one judge in the afternoon or whatever. So that is what the author is suggesting. Use of technology. So this technology will enable them to reduce the burden of the cases and also expedite the cases in a faster manner. Where the technology is needed? The technology is needed in some aspects where the E-Committee of Supreme Court, which was formed in 2005, gave following recommendation. That is, the use of technology must be there in case listing. That is, whenever the case is filed, it has to go to the court. So the case listing has to be done. Case allocation to the particular bench and particular judge has to be done. And adjournments, say for example, if the particular case is adjourned or the case judgment will be talked in some other day, which is called an adjournment, has to be done through these technologies. So the technology will have an algorithm and it will have a software which will list the cases as it is coming, like first in, first out, and it will allocate the cases with the proper judges and the bench, and then it will adjourn and see that the proper timing is there. Say for example, this, if the case A case is listed on this day and it is adjourned to Tuesday, then it is they will ensure that on Thursday it is listed as a first, because this is an adjourned case. So the algorithm in the software will ensure that this is properly done. This, and you can't let it let the algorithm to decide all this, because judiciary is the ultimate authority. So the author is also saying that with only 5% of override given to judges. So say for example, if the case is listed as by the algorithm, it is listed on Thursday on the first case. But the judges feels that this case is very important and it needs to be adjudicated in tonight itself. So the judges can override this algorithm and list the case on the same day on the night. So like this, 5% override is given to the judges is what the author is saying. An e-filing of petitions and affidavits is very required, because the poor or anybody has to go to the lawyer to properly file the cases, because there is a format for writing the petition itself. So the normal people will not know how to write a petition to the court. So they have to go to a lawyer and see how the petition goes or have to done. Instead of that, if it is a standard format provided by the through some software, they'll be able to put in all the words and they'll be able to file a petition and then produce it to the court. And you can also file to the court using that particular digital technology. So the author is saying e-filing of petitions and affidavits is very important. This will save money, save environment, save travel time. So save environment because it will reduce the paperwork. So paper, when it is reduced, there is a reduction in the cutting of case. And hybrid virtual hearings is also one suggestion that the author has given. That is physical as well as virtual. That is using digital technology. So this will ensure that there is a fair opportunity which is provided for young lawyers in small, from small towns. So these young lawyers from small towns will also be able to argue case in the high courts or district courts or the Supreme Court itself through the hybrid virtual hearings is what the author is saying. This hybrid virtual hearing is done in the pandemic, was done in the pandemic times, and this has to continue is what the author is saying. The hardware needed is already there, and there is no need for a law for implementation of these. So as the author is suggesting these things, that is filling sanction, judicial position, holding judiciary accountable, and the technology usage, it does not need a new law to be created for permitting all this. It is already there, and also the hardware is also already there, is also the author is saying. So please do implement it and expedite these suggestions is what the author is saying. The text editorial, a scheme before its time. So this scheme is about the digital health mission, which was announced recently. And it is important because it is in a general studies two topic, issues relating to development and management of social sector services relating to health education. So this important editorial gives you a stock point of all this. Let's discuss. Premise, digital health mission was launched, points to be noted. What is this National Digital Health Mission, which is part of this Ayushman Bharat? In this, each person will be given a health ID, which is having a 14-digit health identification number. So voluntarily, any person can opt for this, and also any hospitals can have this health ID, can be a part of this digital health mission. So it is purely voluntary. Repository of their medical history, like their all the tests have been done in various hospitals, the disease history, the doctors they visited, all will be there in the. So this particular card, which is having this health ID, will also have the medical history. So this is in the digital format. So this ensures that there is a portability of the history of the particular person, and he is able to visit any kinds of hospitals with all the record of the history, whatever tests he has taken in any other hospitals with the particular doctor. Benefits of this particular health mission, which is providing health ID, is this. For patient, it actually reduces cost. So one test taken in another hospital, he can take the same test to the other hospital as well. So there is no need of multiple tests at different hospitals when he is visiting them. So it will reduce cost, and there is an easy management of files. It is when it is all in a digital format. So it is like a DigiLocker which have all your certificates. This digital mode of this digital health mission will have all the history of this particular person. And it is also portable across the hospitals, between the private as well as the public hospitals, even to an insurance agent. So this health record of the person, which is there in the particular digital format, will be able to go to a medical, take a medical insurance or a health insurance, and also he can go to a hospital like private or public hospitals, but he can also go to a government or to get some incentives if there is something, incentive for that particular ailment. And for doctors, well-informed advice after better diagnosis. So he knows, a doctor will know the medical history, and he will be able to give a proper advice based on the medical history. So, and he also give a proper medicine based on knowing that whether he has a kidney stone or something. And what are the challenges? Solution is looking for a problem. So this is very important. So this quote has been used by this author, that is, a solution is provided, but it is looking for a problem. The problem is something else, but the government has given this as a solution, but this will no way take the resolve the problem that is there in the healthcare is what the author is saying. So solution is looking for a problem is what the author is saying. The author is saying the problem is something else. What are the problems? The problem is affordability. A problem is high quality of healthcare. So there is no proper affordability, no quality in the healthcare system that we have. The poor is unable to afford the cost of scanning or the cost of a medical procedure or treatment. And there is a poor quality, even in the private hospital, it is poor quality. And in the public hospital, is even worse. So this is the condition in the healthcare system. So whether this health mission, which is providing health ID, actually will resolve this problem, is what the author is asking. Lack of adequate staffs and doctors. So the staffs to population and the doctors to population ratio is very, very poor. The doctors to population ratio is around 1:1456, which is very poor. And even to the nurse, it is 1:676, which is very, very lesser than the, which is very greater than the what is WHO has standardized. WHO has standardized 1:300 for nurses to population ratio. And for doctors, it is between 1:1000. So this is very, very poor condition of the healthcare system in India. An absence of privacy law and little public awareness and control over their data. So there is a privacy problem when it comes with, when the medical history is there with the hospitals and other agents. So these agents and the medical, that is insurance agents and the hospitals and the government, if they're having the medical history, this affects the privacy, the right to privacy of an individual. So right to privacy is under Article 21, coming under after the Supreme Court judgment of Puttaswamy, in the Puttaswamy case. So privacy is one important problem when it comes to a health ID, which is having the medical history. And there is little public awareness about this digital health mission itself. And the public awareness of whether to provide their medical history to doctors or hospitals is very, very poor. They will not know, but the hospitals will take all the medical history of the individual. Without knowing that their medical history is being public with the hospitals, they will be not having a control over their data. This will affect their right to privacy, right to speech and expression, because when the all the medical history is with the other people, their autonomy, their dignity and anything can be affected because there is no privacy in the medical history. So this is a problem when the fundamental rights can be affected through this health ID. This is one important analysis of the scheme, which is the challenges which the government has to go. Again, this privacy, right to privacy can be challenged in this case of health ID, just like right to privacy challenged the other data. And also you have to understand that there is no production of the data which is there with the government. So this public data protection law, which is not passed yet, is now in the joint with the joint committee. So this data protection law, when it is coming, then it will define the guidelines to protect such medical history or the other data which is there with the government or the private persons from the, which is taken from the public. So this production of the data with the government or other entities is very required for to protect the privacy. But this law has not been passed yet. It is with the joint committee. So there is a problem of privacy is what the author is saying. Construct risk profiles for people and make access to affordable insurance difficult. So the medical insurance will now, knowing the medical history, will say, no, I will not provide medical insurance for this person because this person has the medical history of cancer. So they may die soon. So my medical insurance will not be profitable for the medical insurance agents. So they will profile the risk person and they will deny the insurance for the such a person. So that will create a problem. And it will also make access to affordable insurance difficult. So that is very problematic in the case of medical history being known by the medical insurance agents. Prioritize certain rich demographics for their services. So knowing the medical history and also knowing that this rich people is having, the rich people is having such a medical history, the hospitals can actually tap this information and can persuade the rich people to go for the higher treatment so that they can make money out of it. And they will also prioritize rich people for their services rather than the poor people. So in this medical health ID, there are poor people as well as the rich people who are enrolled in it. But the hospitals will focus only on the rich people and they will not care for the poor people is what the author is criticizing this particular scheme for. And the cost of researching, finding and buying appropriate drugs and treatment, competing systems of medicine and the very challenging nature of health itself is not being resolved by this health ID is what the author is saying. There are lots of problems in the healthcare system. This ID coming of this digital health mission will no way resolve all these problems. The author is saying that please resolve this problem, which is the fundamental and ground reality, and that is the fundamental problem. So fundamental problem has to be resolved, and then go for this digital health mission is what the author is saying. The next last article, a state, a clean sweep and the art of sanitation. This is very important, as yesterday it was day before yesterday it was Gandhi Jayanti. So yeah, yesterday was Gandhi Jayanti, sorry, October 2. So yesterday was Gandhi Jayanti. So we have this Swachh Bharat mission, which was launched in 2014 on the same day. So this is very important because in general studies one, poverty and developmental issues, urbanization, their problems and their remedies, and general studies two, issues relating to development and management of social sectors or services relating to health, education, human resources. So these two important topics in the syllabus actually relate to the Swachh Bharat mission. So this is very important. And also I have clubbed two important editorials for giving you a comprehensive idea about this clean sweep program, that is Swachh Bharat mission, which is otherwise called as Clean India mission. And also the premises, this Swachh Bharat mission 2014 to 2019 is already over, and now the honorable prime minister has come up with Swachh Bharat mission 2.0 and Amrut, that is Atal mission for renewal and urban transformation, is in 2.0 for garbage free and the cities which is renewed from the earlier problems. So there is a 2.0 version which is provided for this Swachh Bharat mission as well as this Amrut mission. Let's take the stock points from this. Points to be noted: the open defecation free India and providing every family with sanitation facilities, which includes toilets, solid and liquid waste disposal, is the motto of this Swachh Bharat mission. What are the processes involved? Understand the ground realities. Here, this article was given by this Chief Minister of Madhya Pradesh, Mr. Shivraj Singh Chauhan. He is saying that how this Swachh Bharat mission is implemented in Madhya Pradesh and how it was very successful. As you know, Indore is one important topmost in the clean cities. So this ensures that Madhya Pradesh Chief Minister to be very, very happy about telling how it was implemented, how it was successful. But there is another editorial which talks about why there is still a problem of clean cities and the cities are still dirty, is what this author is talking about. Let's go into the topics. The process that the Chief Minister of Madhya Pradesh has undergone before introducing the Swachh Bharat mission. What he did, first he understood the ground realities. So he understood what is the reason for such an open defecation and what is the status of this open defecation is what the Chief Minister first did. He went to the areas which are dirty and seeing whether there is an open defecation, why there is an open defecation, how much it is there, and this ground realities was studied by the Chief Minister and the persons associated with Chief Minister's office, and initiate social change. So this social change is very much needed because this sanitation problem is not a economic problem or a political problem. It is a social problem. So there is a need for an initiation of social changes, what the Chief Minister understood when he went to see the reality on the ground. And what are the challenges? The Chief Minister encountered all these challenges. He understood that the people wanted their home to be clean, but not the environment. So there is something called as tragedy of commons. So tragedy of commons is one term which is usually used. So this tragedy of commons is that the environment, say for example, the roads, the public toilets are very unclean and nobody cares to clean that. They think that the government has to clean that or the government authorities or department has to clean that. They don't ensure that it is clean. Because the people are the one who's using, but they don't care to keep it clean. They will accuse government as not doing something. So they want the, and they keep their home clean and they put all the trashes outside on the roads or somewhere else. So this is what the attitude of the people is what the Madhya Pradesh chief minister has understood. They wanted to keep the home clean, but not the environment. So the attitude problem of the people has to be changed. So this requires a social change is what the author is saying. Set aside as government responsibility. So the tragedy of commons, since it is a common, it is the government responsibility is what the people is thinking. And behavior is another problem. This open defecation is one behavioral problem that you have to understand. So they are thinking that going open defecation is very good for the health. And they think that they can breathe good air. And there is a misconception that going to the toilets is not good. And going in the open space is very good. So this behavioral problem is also there. And they don't construct toilets inside the house because a toilet is considered a dirty thing. And there is something called as pollution and purity concept. So the toilets which are considered as a pollution will not be constructed inside the house. So certain caste people, they don't construct the toilets inside the house. They will construct toilets only outside the house. And also, they will not construct a drainage inside the house because those excreta which should not be stored inside the house because it is a pollution. And also, this has created a discrimination against the SC people who are forced to clean such a toilets and remove the excreta from the toilets. So these are some social problems that the people has. So this needs a behavioral change and an attitudinal change is what the chief minister has understood. What are the tools used? Construction of toilets. This is one important move. Yes. Provision of piped water supply. So when there is a toilet, there is a need for a water supply to clean the toilet. And levy fines to offenders who are defecating in the open space. And encouraging behavioral change through innovation. This is one important addition which the chief minister found. The chief minister saying, I could have just constructed a toilet and kept myself simple. But the chief minister is saying, I understood the problem and I understood even if the toilet is constructed, it will not be used because water is not there. Or even if the water is given and the toilets are functional, still it will not be used because that's a behavioral problem. The people will not go into the public toilets or they will not construct toilets in their house and they will not clean the toilets by themselves because they consider it as a pollution. So there is a need for an attitudinal change and social behavioral change. So there is a need for some innovation to trigger their behavioral change. This is what the chief minister has understood. And so he started encouraging behavioral change through innovation, like communication-based and engineering solution. So there is a term called as social engineering. Social engineering is something which will create a behavioral change or a social change in order to meet certain interest or needs. So this social engineering, say for example, the advertisements are doing social engineering to buy certain products. So they're engineering your liking and demand, your attitude towards a product, and they are able to make you a consumer of their products. So this social engineering has to also be done in the case of the government program of using such toilets and stopping open defecation. So by stopping open defecation and for using toilet, they have to do a social engineering to create an awareness among the people that they should use the toilets in order to have a clean surroundings and clean India and a clean world. So that is what the chief minister has understood and he has done that also. And so that has resulted in lots of impacts. And also he understood that there is need for a good leadership to make the people to behave in a right manner, in a sustained manner. Because only a good leader will ensure that there is a constant behavioral change that the people are ensuring that they are not open defecating and they're using the toilet. So there is a good leadership which is required. And this leadership can be provided by the collectors and also the grassroots leaders like the local panchayat leaders and others is what the chief minister has Understood. So he has empowered the local government and the local grassroots level leaders like ASHA workers, the Anganwadi workers, the collectors, and the Tahsildars and others who are in the grassroots level. So good leadership for sustained change in behaviors. And also he ensured the people must be participating. The people must be using the toilet. They must be ensure there is a proper maintenance. If there is no proper water is coming, the public has to ensure that the water is coming by calling the collectors or the tahsildars to ensure that there is a proper water. So people participation, if at all, is provided. If the people is owning the movement, that is clean India will actually save their life and save the environment and keep the women safe. Because the women are going to open defecation only in the night because they feel shy going open during the daytime, and the places are used by the men during the daytime, so they go in the night, so that is creating a safety issues for the women. So this toilets when constructed will actually help the women. So the women will also participate in this particular moment of construction of toilet. So women will be very happy to go to the toilet and relieve herself in the daytime also. So this ensures there is a people participation, and the people, not just the women, but all the people, because women cannot do anything singular. So they need support of all the people, like the panchayat of the system and the family support, everything they needed for construction of toilets and maintenance of toilets. So the people have to participate and own the movement is what the chief minister has understood, and he has ensured that it is done. And what are the impacts? Swachh Sarvekshan survey. So this survey which studies whether the cities are adopted the Swachh Bharat mission and has ensured the success in this Swachh Bharat mission, has understood that this Indoor is the cleanest city among all. And at this Madhya Pradesh government has able to attain the goal in 2017 itself instead of 2019. So they are far ahead in attaining the outcome is what the chief minister is very pride about. And India's first water surplus city, that is India's first water plus city in survey 2021 of Swachh Sarvekshan, says that this Bhopal has ensured that it is the first water plus city in the Madhya Pradesh. So wastewater treatment has been done in a vigorous manner, in a comprehensive manner, to ensure that the water is very clean in Bhopal. Bhopal shown the way for other capitals as well. So Bhopal's best practices can be adopted by other capital is what the chief minister is saying. And what is the approach? Actually, the chief minister is highlighting various approaches which you can use it in any of the problems and any of your answer writing. Please ensure you are using these words. Approach, first approach, multi-pronged approach. Multi-pronged approach is you are seeing in all angles and you are able to address the problem in all the angles, social, economic, and even in the social, you are seeing it as resolving the women's problem. You are using the women and you are resolving the problem of the panchayat system and using the panchayat system. So like this, there is a multi-pronged approach wherein you're using all the stakeholders, all the resources and all the angles, that is all the field in the process. And then all the hands on the deck approach. This is another approach. That is every person are involved in the Swachh Bharat mission and making it a success. So every person will focus and use their efforts to streamline in order to make a clean India. An integrated sanitation approach. So what is this integrated sanitation approach? This you have to ensure. See, this sanitation will ensure there is a healthy individual. And this sanitation cannot simply be done by construction of toilet. There is a water which is needed. So water department will be coming into play. Health department will come into play. Even the agriculture department will come into play. Because in this construction of toilets, you have to ensure that the MGNREGA workers were used. The MGNREGA scheme was used for construction of toilets. So there is a need for an integrated sanitation approach. And even education department was coming into play because toilets have to be constructed in the schools also. So the schools were also involved in the process of toilets, functional toilets. Functional toilets mean which can be used properly, and there is a proper water supply, there is a proper sanitation facility, and there is a sanitation facility for the women to dispose the napkins and others. And so that is needed at the school levels also. So the education department is also coming into play. So there is an integrated sanitation approach is also needed. And also education department is also coming into play because the students have to be nurtured that they have to use toilets, because it has to start from the children. The children has to habituated to use the toilets. So there is a need for an integrated sanitation approach. And sanitation is not just using toilets, it is also washing the hands properly and also disposing of trash properly. So all these are sanitation. So that is requiring an integrated sanitation approach. And what is the critical analysis? This is coming from another article. The critical analysis is that the author is saying the chief minister has been very proud about all these achievements. But the author of the another editorial is saying there is some problem still. Dirty and dysfunctional cities are still there. And low per capita income of the cities are causing low management capacity of urban bodies. So when the income of the people in the urban cities are poor, they will not pay proper taxes. And so the urban governance will not be happening because there is poor income in the government side, urban government side also. So there is a low management capacity of urban bodies. An issue of capability and governance, that is solid waste management must be done. So for solid waste management, there must be a processing plant. For processing plant, the capacity must be higher because there is lots of waste which is produced in a city now, because lots of population is increasing in the urban area. So population increasing, equally the waste generated by them are increasing. So the waste processing plant must be increased in capacity, but the capacity of the waste management plant are not sufficient in order to meet the waste which is generated by the population in the urban areas, what the author is saying. So issue of capability and governance. So the urban management is unable to cater to the needs of a large population which is producing lots of waste. So that is what the author is saying. So able to process only 1 lakh tons of solid waste compared to 1.4 lakh tons annually, which is generated. And need for a community involvement by providing tangible incentives. Madhya Pradesh government, Chief Minister also said there needs to be a people participation. Same, the author is also saying there is a need for a community involvement so that the community, when they are involved, they are owning the scheme and they are also involved in the success of the scheme is what the author is saying. So there should be a community involvement, but community involvement cannot be done just like that. Though you communicate them, they need some incentives. They need something to get back to their home. So this community involvement must be provided with tangible incentives. Say, for example, if they are segregating the plastic waste and the wet waste and the dry waste, they should be provided incentives of, say, for example, there are some scheme which were earlier that the weight of the, they will be paid for the plastic waste. So they can be given such a tangible incentives for them to segregate the waste at the source. So when the segregation happens at the source, it will be easier for the disposal and the processing and the recycling or the recycling or processing of the such a waste. So there is a need for a community involvement which will ensure there is a segregation of the waste at the source level. That is, dry waste and waste, wet waste are segregated. So the wet waste will go for a composting that will act as a manure for the agriculture field, and the dry waste will be recycled and it will be used again for the plastic materials and others, or like papers and all. Paper will be recycled and again used as for paper production. Like this, it can be used. And proper water connections and public rental housing are needed. So water connection is needed. As everyone talked about in this COVID pandemic, everyone wanted for you to clean the hands and wash the hands properly. There is no proper water supply. Say for example, in the Coimbatore, there is no proper water supply is what the people were saying. We need to wash our hands, but where are the water supplies? Whether the public toilets are properly maintained is what the thing. And there are lots of destitutes who are not having housing. So whether they will be going to a toilet, they will be doing open defecation only. So you have seen many people who are sleeping under the bridges. They are going, they are just defecating in the open only, in the cities I'm talking about, not in the rural areas. So cities. So these cities requires public rental housing for these destitutes and who's not having proper house. So when you go for a public rental housing, then you can provide a toilet there itself. And then the people will be ensuring that the toilets are used and they are not openly defecating. These are the suggestions and the analysis which the author made in another editorial. And I'm just giving certain words which were discussed in this particular editorial. That is ODF, ODF plus, ODF plus plus. What is this ODF? ODF means open defecation free. So this is ODF, that is open defecation free, will require a toilet to be constructed. But open defecation free plus means there is a community or public toilet which is used. That is, it is properly operated and maintained. And ODF plus plus means there is a fecal sludge manager. That is, the ODF means just a toilet. ODF plus means the toilet is used and there is a proper water supply and it is maintained properly by cleaning and all. And ODF plus plus means the excreta which is coming in the toilet has to be managed. That is, it has to be recycled or processed and the water which is coming from the toilet have to be processed and recycled and used again. But you have to ensure that what is the water which is coming from this toilets? Clean water, gray water, and black water. So there is some classification in the water. Black water is the water which is coming from toilets or that is containing harsh chemicals. So the toilets, the water which is coming from the toilet has to be managed, has to be recycled in order to ensure that it is clean again. So there is something called as black water. There is something also called as gray water. These water are used to water from sinks, showers, bath, and laundry without harsh chemicals. So they can be used in the gardening and other facilities with little processing or even without processing also. So these are the classifications of the water. So again, every time I also end up with these fact for maids. So these are the facts I found from Indian Express as well as Hindu newspaper. So please ensure that you are taking a screenshot and then noting down in your notes. Then I also have certain announcement and words to make. The 50th edition, that is the very grand 50th edition, that is the next edition will be done by Adil Bey, but after a week, that is since this October 10, we have this prelims 2021. I give my hearty wishes for all those who are writing this prelims 2021. Ensure that you are reading the question twice or thrice and then properly shading and take a comfortable water and properly sleep the day before and then have a fresh mind so that your presence of mind actually works out on the day of the prelims. And also ensure that your proper health and all the instructions are followed properly. So all the best for the prelims. And you will meet our grand 50th edition with Adil Bhai or after this October 10th. And also ensure that you are safe and secure throughout this day. And throughout this week, it is very crucial for you. So please ensure that you are in a cool mind. And also you're ensure you're drinking lots of water. And also ensure that you're not traveling so much because this COVID is another problem which is a challenge for everyone. So please ensure that you are safe and secure and you are doing good in this prelims. And I wish for all them a great success in this prelims and hope to meet you as an audience in the 50th edition with Adil Bhai. So thank you for listening. And any doubts, please ping in the comments as well as in the Telegram that we are there. So please ensure your doubts are all cleared. Thank you. Consider subscribing, liking, and sharing this video with your friends. So being an UPSC aspirant is a great journey and this journey will be starting from your prelims and this prelims of 2021 is one major D-Day for you. So ensure that you're making it. And for others who are preparing and will be giving in 2022, ensure that you're continuing this editorial video and this video will continue on the, we'll skip 1 week and we'll start from October 10 afterwards. Thank you once again. We will meet with more videos also after prelims for your mains preparation. Thank you.